From NPR Music, I'm Bob Boilen, and today you're in for a treat. Mikel Jollett of the Airborne Toxic Event is going to join me and talk about this extraordinary new memo. It's called Hollywood Park, and then the subsequent album he made based on this story, his life story. It's a journey. It begins with Mikel as a very, very young child. He's growing up in Synanon, which is a drug rehab facility, but turned cult. He's separated from his parents. The book is this amazing journey of, in the end, which is what it means to be a family. So joining me from East West Studios in Hollywood, California, Mikel Jollett.
Hey, buddy. Hi, Bob. How are you?
Good. So good to see you.
Great to see you.
For nice hat. No, I've had this a little while. Yeah. That's Big Bird's feather, by the way.
Oh, wow. Yeah. Very horn section vibe. There's a saxophone vibe happening somewhere.
Oh, man. Now I need to play. For those who are in the chat room before we get started, let us know where you're watching from. And if you have questions, we'll take a few. We'll go through the chat room and call some chat comments. And also, like, take a second and tell your friends this is happening right now. Because the next 45 minutes or so, Mikel's going to sing some songs and tell some stories and extraordinary stories. Mikel, I want to start with giving folks out there who haven't read the book yet a flavor of what's in store in this book. So if you'd actually read a small section of the book from the top, well, not the
you
very
want
to top
start
of
with
the
that?
Book. Yeah, I think so. I think it gives us all... a little bit what we're in.
Okay, this is from the opening chapter of Hollywood Park. We've been living in Synanon, which is a drug rehabilitation facility that my dad went to when he got out of prison to get clean off heroin. And he met my mother there, who was a free speech activist from Berkeley. They met, they got married. And then, you know, it was this very utopian vision of society that spiraled out of control into madness. And one of the pieces of the madness, in addition to the violence that happened and the sort of, let's say, the psychological violence that happened, were the children. One of the more difficult things to write about, all the children were put into an orphanage. So I was raised there until nearly four, and my brother until he was nearly seven. And we didn't know our parents because in the cult, you weren't allowed to have parents. So the book is written from my perspective as a small child. And then, of course, as I get older, my perspective as a grade school student, and then eventually as a rebellious preteen, and then an adult trying to make sense of everything. So this is the day my mom shows up. We don't really know what it means to have a mom or a dad. We just didn't know. Because the cult was becoming violent, she came to rescue us, to bust us out. So this is from the end of that chapter. And my brother's name is Tony, he's there as well. I look at Tony's face for clues, but he's got his chin pressed against the doorframe, holding the paper bag with his stuff in it. My head feels woozy as my eyes fall on the buttons of Debbie's blue overalls. She's nice, but she's new. I miss Clubby, because she used to be with us at night and would hold me when I had a bad dream and call me Thun. She would tell me we were safe here, all of us here in Synanon, living together, a great big family. A tribe of humans who love each other and love the world and love the little babies most of all. Debbie whispers something to Mom. Tony is mad. I'm told he's my brother. I see him on the playground, but he never plays with the other kids. He sits by himself. I sit by him sometimes, but I don't think he likes me because he pushes me and tells me to leave him alone. He's 3 years older and twice my size. People say we look like each other, but I don't see it. Mom picks us up. She seems so much like a giant bird. Like she swooped down from the sky and got us. And I want to tell her not to worry, that I can fly too. I'm strong enough, and sometimes when I'm dreaming, my ears get big, big enough to be like wings, and I can fly anywhere I want. I just flap them and soar way up into the sky. I tell myself, remember, you have to remember this when you wake up. You can fly. And I'm remembering now because I just woke up, and I want to tell her, but there's no time. She beats her wings, and we take flight over the school, the playground, the yard, the field, the buildings, the entire Synanon compound where we played games and ate and sang and slept, where we heard the adults screaming through the speakers of the wire, the in-house radio with its crackle and hiss, letting us hear the sounds of people laughing, people crying, people yelling, people dancing, a jazz band playing music, the punk squad, the mean teenagers with their cursing and cuffed jeans getting punched in the face if they ever talk back. Every week, one of them runs away and everybody gets so mad. The sound of Chuck, the old man, the leader, talking about things we don't understand. He says he loves us, but he's always so angry. And the bird. We're told to call her mom, flapping furiously, her eyes locked on some faraway point as she clutches her chicks, and we fly up over Tamales Bay with its streams draining into the Pacific Ocean, the giant redwoods on the hillside, the big waves crashing against the rocks on the coast, slowly breaking them into tiny pieces, fracturing them, pulling them apart till they're soft to the touch, portable and broken, easy to walk on, to place into a small plastic bag for a tourist visiting with sunburned ankles from some ancient city to the east.
What were the kind of, I just wanted one thing in the chat room. People might not know this is a memoir. This is not a book of fiction. So all that we talk about today is about your life, to make that clear at the top. What were the consequences of leaving? I mean, it's not like you just walk out.
Yeah, they were threatening to murder people who left. They had stockpiled about 1,000 rifles. There was a goon squad called the Imperial Marines that Chuck Dietrich, who was the leader of Synanon, had recruited and were doing drills in the field. And this is, you understand, this is a place that started as a nonviolent society. Right. Violence wasn't, you know, allowed at all. And it devolved, as cults do, it devolved. And so we were risking, you know, getting beat up. We were risking getting found. Once we did leave, we were always told there was just this refrain, the bad men are coming. You got to hide. We weren't allowed outside that first year at all. When we went to hide in Oakland and Berkeley, we just stayed inside because we were worried that the bad men were going to come. So we essentially lived on the run for about a year and a half before we eventually, you know, went to Oregon, which was sort of like our sanctuary. It was like Salem, Oregon in the rain. It's like 1981. The feeling was like the hippies lost. And I wasn't a hippie. I was just a kid. You know, I didn't know. I was just trying to piece the world together. And so was my brother, you know, but I think the feeling was like Reagan is president, you know, the mental hospital
Reagan
closed. And here's Reagan, who was like my mom's arch nemesis from the civil rights, the free speech movement at Berkeley, because he was governor of California and he's president now. And it was like they lost that whole generation. It all the high-minded ideals. There were still, I think, we forget how much in the 80s the ghosts of Vietnam was still with us, that there were still so, like, early 80s, you still had so many vets walking around the streets and so many people were for whom the horrors of that war were still very fresh, and they were still very fresh in the American consciousness as well. So I think there was just this feeling of defeat. And like, it just didn't work out. All these high-minded ideals sort of devolved into madness, and now it was, here we were hiding away.
And the bad men did come, and you witnessed such a horrible thing sitting on your porch in the driveway with Phil. Tell us about Phil. And
yeah, sorry.
You okay?
It's okay. I'm sorry about this. Yeah, it was tough. We moved to a house in Berkeley. We weren't allowed outside. And one day, Phil, who was, you know, I wouldn't say he was like a father figure, but there weren't any men around, and we had a single mom because our parents had split. But he was this really nice man. He was a anti-nuclear weapon activist, and he's still like a big activist these days. He was trying to shut down the Diablo Canyon reactor, and he lived with us, and he was a friend. They were friends, and he was friends with us, and his daughter was friends with us, and he was this nice man. And I'd always come out when he got home. You know, and it was one of the days my brother finally wore my mom down, was allowed to play outside because we weren't generally allowed to do that. And so he was across the street, and my brother was. And, you know, Phil came home in his orange VW bus, like any good hippie. He had an orange VW bus. and he parked the bus in the driveway, and he got out, and these two men walked. And I didn't know at the time what it was, but they had this flesh mask like you see in movies like bank robbers, where I assume they were nylons or something. And they were holding these short batons. They weren't quite baseball bats. I mean, they might have been pipes. I don't know. They were black. And he got out, and he smiled at me, and they just walked up behind him and started beating him. And he fell on the ground, and he started screaming. And our eyes locked. They beat him into a coma. And it was, yeah, I was on the porch. It was 5 feet in front of me. My brother watched from across the street. And then once they were done, they sort of, one of them sort of straightened up and said, "Where's Tony and Mikel?" And he didn't see me because I was hiding behind a part of the porch. And he looked across the street. And then my brother was with a group of kids. And, you know, they didn't know his name. And they didn't know my name because we weren't ever allowed to play with them because we were always locked inside, unable to play. So then, you know, the neighbor lady came out and started screaming and everyone was just terrified. And then the ambulance came and, I mean, the men left and then the ambulance came. And that's when we realized we had to leave California and sort of go somewhere else. And we ended up in Salem, Oregon.
One of the striking things that goes throughout the book is your relationship with your mom. And you had this way about you from very young that tried to please her all the time.
Yeah. But I think different kids respond to stressful situations in different ways. And so much of the book, you know, I try to write about this from the perspective of the child who's trying to figure it out. I realized about halfway through writing the book, what I was really doing was giving this child a voice, this child that never had a voice, because no one ever asked us how we felt. No one ever said, "Hey, maybe we should get these kids some therapy. They left an orphanage. They witnessed crazy violence. They're terrified. They're traumatized." It was just, we were treated sort of as accessories to all this. In giving that kid a voice, I realized how much I very early understood that was sort of my role. You know, different kids take on different roles in families. And sometimes it's because of alcoholism. Sometimes it's, you know, it could be cancer, you know, poverty itself. One kid becomes a super kid. One kid becomes the scapegoat. One kid becomes what's called the mascot. And these things are sort of predictable and they take on. My brother was very much the rebel scapegoat child that was just like, he was there to cause trouble. Yeah. And very early on.
To you as well, not just your
mom. Yeah, to me as well. He spent a lot of time. All told, I spent about 2 years of my life in a headlock. You add it up. I think I very early on was like, I'll be the super kid. I'll try to rise above this. I'll take care of everyone. I'm gonna get up before dawn, make breakfast, go spend 3 hours doing chores. We raised rabbits for meat because we didn't have, you know, we lived on food stamps and government cheese and all that kind of stuff, and we raised vegetables and stuff. So I would get up when it was cold and the rabbit bowls froze over, whatever, and you know, I'd be like 8 years old out there for 3 hours replacing all the water and then go to school and then come home and chop the wood because we didn't have a heater. We just had a stove, like a wood stove, and then try to make sure my mom's okay and be sort of her caretaker because she was severely depressed. She dealt with crippling depression her whole life, and then try to keep my brother at bay. And then, of course, when I was writing the book and I was giving voice to my brother, I kind of came to have a different understanding of him, because at the time I would have said, oh, he was just kind of being a jerk. And then he's so mad, and just all growing up, he was so mad. He was always calling him out. And he's like, "This is bullshit." He would say that. He was like 10 years old. "This is bullshit. What are we doing? We eat rabbits, supposed to be eating hamburger meat and ice cream. Like, what is this? Why are we running from this and that? Why can't I just go play baseball?" And you know, at the time, I think I resented it. And now when I wrote it, I look back like, this kid's speaking truth. This is the one kid that sees it clearly. Like, and it really gave me a lot more, you know, his response probably was in some ways emotionally more healthy than mine, which was to try to pretend I was, you know, could outrun it or outlast it or something.
And your mom, who you were always trying to please, and her sense of reality was, well, I mean, she had her own issues and she dealt with her own sense of reality. You'd say to her, "Hey, I'm hungry." And she says, "No, you're not. You ate earlier," right. You know, and all this wound up leading to you running away. I mean, we're talking now age-wise.
Age-wise.
We started around 4 in Synanon. We're now, what, at about age 11.
Yeah, 10 years old.
Yeah.
10 or 11. Yeah. My first stepdad had left or died. We weren't sure which. He was a good man, but a severe alcoholic, but a nice guy. And he'd always take us fishing down by the Willamette River.
I love those stories.
Salem. And then my second stepdad, you know, there's this thing in memoir writing where you're always supposed to look for the good and care in people you're writing about. And I tried to do that a lot with, you know, my brother or my mom or, you know, my dad or whatever, where you, if someone's presented to you that you have a difficult relationship with, you try to see what they're struggling with and write about that. You have to write from a place of love. And I think the one person in my whole life that I don't feel any need to do that about is my second stepdad.
Right. That was clear.
I don't know what the literary, you know, I don't know how you put it in literature that, you know, someone was just a jerk, but he just was. And so, yeah, I wouldn't say he was like some monstrous violent person so much as he would spend a lot of time intimidating me. And then one night it, you know, he'd stand over me and he'd beat my dog and he'd threaten me. And then one night it blew over and he called me some names. And then, or I called my mother some names and then he got in the face and got in my face and pinned me down and he, you know, beat me. And then I got up and wiped my tears and got on my bike and went, I ran away. It was late at night. I was maybe 10 years old. And I went to the West Salem Bridge, which is where I would spend with my first stepdad, who was this warm, he was a drunk, but he was a great drunk. You know, he was a kind drunk. He was a fuzzy drunk. He was like, yeah, okay, I had trouble holding down a job, but he was a good guy. You know, he watched cartoons with us. And he was also just a place of warmth for us in a world that we didn't have a lot of that. And so I went looking for him. That's that night. And then I assume we're introducing the song here. Is that?
I'd love for you to play Come On
Out. So the album Hollywood Park, which is the soundtrack, we're going to play. We're going to bring Mimi from the Airborne Toxic Event over as well. And she's going to sit in with me. And we're going to play the song Coming Out, which is based on that night. Everyone, Mimi Pache, the wonderful, hey, talented Mimi Pache, who shreds.
Welcome.
And we're going to play a bit of, I guess we're going to play all of Coming Out, which is the story of that night.
Black lungs, headlights, heading off to the city tonight. Out the front door, turn right. I was alone, alright, alright, alright. I wonder what they'll think of me. I'll run away, run away. This is my town, my night. Heading off to the city tonight. And she said, come on out with it, 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 come on out with it. Hard words on a hot night. Have a beer, won't you turn out the light from the front door? I could hear right. I'm just running dumb and dumb and dumb and dumb. Wonder if I'll be turning back. I got 20 bucks in a pocket with my stash. I'm not afraid, not your good night. Just a shadow of the shadows tonight. And she said, come on out with it, come on out with it, come on out with it, come on out. In the night shadows watching the darkness approaching, you came for life in the park. So you stand on a stage at such a young age, as you're feeling around in the dark. And your mother, she's calling. You feel your hopes falling. There's nowhere to run to tonight. Just the fist on your face now. You hope to replace how the emptiness fills you inside. Break my fall. Break my fall. Please break my fall. Break my fall. Please break my fall. Break my fall. Come on out.
awesome. I've had some questions in the chat room sort of about beginning just to think about, like, why write this?
Yeah.
And and how do you begin to do that? How do you begin to think about your life? And the detail blew my mind. I didn't talk about that.
It's a good question. Thank you. My father died about 5 years ago, and my whole world just fell apart. And I became very depressed. I hardly left the house for about 9 months. And everyone knows grief is sad. I didn't understand how confusing grief could be. Like, I was baffled by it. It was like the laws of physics changed. And I remember thinking, like, I don't understand a world that doesn't have my dad in it. And so I initially had read Between the World and Me, Ta-Nehisi Coates's book, which is sort of the conceit of the book is that it's a letter to his son. And I just thought, here's a really powerful way to think about writing as an homage, or you're writing for an audience of a person. I think that's the book I initially set out to write, like maybe like kind of like a letter to my father. And then as I got into it, I realized I wanted to write something else, because trying to explain to myself why my father's death hit me so hard, it led to new questions. Well, he was the first person I ever trusted. That's why it hit me so hard. Okay, well, why was he the first person you ever trusted? Well, see, I was born in an orphanage. Well, okay, so that orphanage was inside a cult. Okay, but also, and it was like, here was this whole world that I had to wrestle with. So I decided I was going to write from the perspective by starting at the place of my earliest memory, which is the day we left Synanon. And a lot of the early detail, a lot of what I did was I did a lot of world building. So memory is like this string, like you start to pull it and then you get more and more and more, the more time you spend on it. And Toni Morrison has this wonderful idea that memories, it's called re-memory. Memory lives in places. If you go to a place, the memory is still there in the place where it happened. So I don't know if you've ever had the experience of going to like your childhood home.
Absolutely.
You haven't been to. And then you're awash, and suddenly things you hadn't thought about in 20 years.
Right, all your friends are there, and you know.
And you can smell the food. You can smell the, you know, the carpet. You can, and then you remember not just that, but entire things that happened in your life, entire attitudes that you no longer have because you've grown or because you've changed. So I would do that. I would go to different places that the book took place, and I would just write down or, you know, memorialize into a tape recorder, like, everything I remembered. And then I'd go home and I'd write around that until I had a good, you know, usually it was between 20 and 40 pages per place. So there's like, you know, Salem, Oregon, and the house there, there's Synanon, there's Playa del Rey, the apartment there, the house in Westchester, various parts of my adult life. And I would just go to these places and then write about them. And then I would call contemporaries that were there as well. And particularly, and compare notes, you know, you want to make sure you're not the only, am I remembering this right? How do you remember this? And try to make sure. And sometimes people would be like, yeah, it's exactly how I remember it. And sometimes they'd be like, no, that's not what happened. What happened?
Right. Well, I'm sure if you asked your mom, I mean, the way you both looked at the world was so different that she would remember things very different than you.
Yeah, of course. I compared notes with people, and then, when I was synthesizing, particularly the early stuff, you know, the first couple chapters are written from the perspective of we, and I got a lot of detail from those few chapters, mostly from my brother, because he was a lot older than I was at that point. So between all those different events, it was like, once I had the places, then I could just, and this was about 6 months before I wrote a single word of the book. I spent 6 months doing this. And then when I got into it, then I could just write. I could think about the story. I could think about how things were being said. I could think about how I was bringing new people in, new characters. And so I didn't have to think so much about, all right, what do I remember about this? Because I'd already done all that footwork. Mm-hmm. And I could just be like, oh, this is taking place at the house on Braes Avenue. Let's open that document. And then, okay, that's the world. All right, go. And that helped a lot because, you know, a lot of this book does a lot of things, you know, memoirs aren't supposed to do, I guess. You know, there's magical realism in the book. There's an unreliable narrator. I say things that are patently untrue because I believe them. You know, I'm 6 years old. I believe some of the lies I'd been told, and I wanted the reader to go on this journey with me. And my feeling was that these things are usually considered kind of the province of fiction, but I felt that wasn't necessary, that we construct our identity around magical realism. That's why we have, you know, mythology. That's why we have religion. It's why we have all kinds of different ways in which we think about our lives in these ways. We are oftentimes unreliable narrators of our own experience. So I thought, you know, why can't I put these in a memoir? Why can't I use these ideas to probe how I came to understand what had happened and who I was, and to let the reader go on this journey with me, because that's what it was. It was a journey of discovering what was real and what wasn't when I had started from a place where I'd been told a lot of things that just turned out to not be true. And then I later realized this is what happens to a lot of traumatized children, that they start in a place where no one's really listening to them and they're being told lies, and they have to slowly, you know, figure out the things that are true.
There was a moment, you're a runner. Your family comes to watch you in a race that you win. But your motivation is to not be like your father.
Yeah.
You talk about this empty chair. And not only his failures are your motivation to success, but you can't tell him that. And there was something deeply striking about that.
Yeah, there was a time when we didn't really know our dad very well. I remember he came to see me on my sixth birthday, and that was that's like when I really remember my relationship with him starting. And we'd seen each other before that. I'd seen him in Synanon and stuff, but. And he was this mythological figure to us. He was like, you know, Clint Eastwood meets James Dean. You know, he was just this, we saw him, you know, he'd
paint this picture. I mean, what he looked like, how he dressed.
He had this big Jim Croce mustache and a white boy pro. And, you know, he only made it to like eighth grade before he started, you know, what he calls, you know, basic mischief, but which was really like he was involved in a life of crime until he was about 25, 26. And, you know, they would steal cars and run bad credit card numbers and sell drugs and stuff. And he'd tell us about it. He was never like shy about telling us about his time in prison or his time as a professional criminal. And we'd be like, Dad, was it kind of like organized crime? Was this like, and he'd be like, well, it's like disorganized crime. We were too high to be organized. And that's who he was. He was warm and he was funny, and he was clean, by the way, too. Unlike most people who had that experience, he actually did clean up and he turned it around. In my entire life, he never got so much as a parking ticket. So wow. This was all just kind of something we knew about his past. Nothing we ever experienced, but we experienced was this wise man who'd seen everything.
But you were literally running from that past of his.
Well, as I got older. So as a child, I worshiped.
Yeah, I see.
It was just like, that's the province of children. My dad can beat up your dad. My dad's better ass than your dad or whatever. You know, my dad had the coolest life ever. And then by high school, I decided it was very important for me to go to college. I wanted to get out. I wanted to be get to this next level in my life. I was a standout athlete and I was a very dedicated student. And it was that, and that world suddenly it switched. And then I kind of, and in the SAT prep world, in the, you know, AP class world, I resented he couldn't help me with my homework, and the fact that he had gone to prison. All the other kids in my classes, their parents were engineers and doctors and lawyers, and my dad, it felt like this mark of shame, you know, that my dad had been to prison and my dad couldn't help me with these things, and I started to feel ashamed of it. And so when I ran, I would always have this image. I was a distance runner, and a lot of what you do is you just have to fight the fatigue and the pain and push through it, and there's a lot of toughness with distance runners. And my way of doing that was I would picture my dad and my brother, because my brother was also a big rebel, sitting in two chairs, and then there'd be this third chair and it was empty, and that chair was for me, and it was like in a jail cell, and that's where I was going to end up. And it would literally drive me to the point I would be so angry, where I don't want to be like you. I don't want to be like you, which of course then was also complicated by the fact that he was a lovely man.
Yeah.
You know, he was a kind, warm hearted. Everyone loved my dad. Everyone. The kids on the street loved my dad. The family liked that. He's funny. And so I had a lot of mixed feelings about it, because he was the place of warmth for my brother and I, and affection and kindness and wisdom. And at the same time, as I wanted to sort of blaze my own path, and I felt like I was trapped by his choices.
Hmm. You want to bring Mimi back? And
Mimi, you want to come talk?
Tell us about All at Once while we set up.
All at Once is a song about the world changing all of a sudden. And sometimes that can be the death of a person that's really important to you. And sometimes it could be, let's just say, a massive pandemic. And you're suddenly living in a new world that you didn't think that you would be living in.
We were born without time, nameless in the arms of a mother, a father, and God. When the world would wait for us, 1,000 years in the crush of our eyes, fearless and dark. Quietly we'd fade into sleep with nothing on our minds.
Mimi Pache, everyone. Mimi Pache.
Nice.
French wonder.
It's good to hear that song in that way. So let's talk about Jake. And your discovery of Robert Smith, your discovery of music.
So there was a new kid from Nebraska that came to our class when I was in fifth grade.
And you asked him, where's Nebraska?
Yeah, I didn't know Nebraska. And he walked into the class. And first of all, he was 11 years old and 6'3" already. So he was this giant. You know, we were all these normal size little kids. And he was already 6'3". And he was sitting in this desk and behind me reading a Hardy Boys book. And my teacher asked me to take him under my wing. I struck up a conversation. We started chatting, as you know, as kids do. So you're new here, what you doing, you know? And then out of nowhere, he swore in front of me. He said, you know, I don't know, man, we do a lot of bullshit. And I was like, ooh, this is a test. You know, like 11 years old. Oh, someone's swearing. I could swear. And I was like, yeah, man, there's a lot of fucking bullshit around here. So I'm kind of, we do like calligraphy and fractions and bullshit, other bullshit like that. So we went to his house, and he was living in a similar situation, you know, government cheese and food stamps and whatnot, and had some struggles with his own parents. And so he brings me upstairs, and he's like, I gotta play something for you. We went up to his room, and he puts this record on, and it sounds like these guitars that are underwater, and there's this warble of a voice, and I didn't know, you know, what it was. And it turned out to be The Head on the Door by The Cure. And I liked it. Though I think he made me some mixtapes, some Cure mixtapes from all the different records, and I didn't understand how these songs could simultaneously feel so happy and so sad. And it felt so different from, you know, so much of the music that was popular, pop music at the time, was about winning. It was about how hard can you party, you know, how badass are you if it's, you know, whatever. And nobody was writing songs about losers, and we were losers. And I don't mean to say we were like total losers that like were screw ups or anything. I just meant we had lost something.
Yeah, something that you could identify with that wasn't in the everyday culture because.
Right.
Yeah.
And it felt like it made it okay to feel messed up, because we felt messed up a lot of the time, and it was okay. And it was like a relief. And it was also, incidentally, this gateway, it was like a door we walked through. We're just these white trash kids in rainy Salem, Oregon. And here's these people, and they're from this place called England. And they're making this amazing music that's about how sad they are and how screwed up they feel and how angry they can be. And there's anguish. And I think it was the Smiths, and it was, you know, The Cure and David Bowie and things like that. And it was like, it was artistic, and it was clever, and it was sarcasm. And it just made the pop music or the heavy metal or everything just kind of sound like we were no longer interested. And it felt like finding like-minded souls, I guess. It was like felt like a relief. There was a relief to it all, it felt like being seen, like, this is our music. This is who we're. And it was always on everywhere we went. We'd go camping. We had one of those like cassettes, dual cassette players, you know, 20 batteries. We'd walk through the woods, you know, playing Louder Than Bombs or something.
You are the one.
That was ruining people's walks. You know? And just, we liked feeling unlovable.
About how old when this is?
This was, yeah, like preteen, let's say 11 to 13 or so. Like this is what we did. And this is what we did constantly, Jake and I, everywhere we went. We were obsessed with David Bowie. We were obsessed with Morrissey. In our minds, Morrissey got all the girls. That's what we used to always say. Morrissey gets all the girls.
At that age, that's important.
Yeah.
But talk about picking up the guitar for the first time.
Yeah.
What's the distance between finding the cure, so to speak, And then picking up that guitar from your aunt?
Another 2 years went by, and at which point I'd moved to Los Angeles, and I had a friend who had acoustic guitar, my friend Drew, in Westchester, Los Angeles, California. Westchester's kind of this suburb. And we went from living with my mom, which was very difficult, to living with my dad and my mom, Bonnie, which she's my stepmom, but we don't use the S word in my family because, you know, she was also my caretaker in Synanon. Which is a whole thing that I talk about a lot in the book, but she's essentially been a mom to me since I was 6 months old. So I just call her my mom. And they were great parents, and there was finally some room to breathe. There was finally some sense like, okay, people care. We can just be the kids that we want to be. There's food to eat. There's not this constant crisis happening. My friend Andrew had a guitar. It was like an acoustic guitar. And what's that Smiths line? You know, I thought if you had an acoustic guitar, it meant you were a protest singer. I think at the time, the first time I saw an acoustic guitar, I was like, what is he, a cowboy? What is this thing like? Because I was like, electric guitars, rock and roll, you know, I want to see like a Jaguar or something. Like,
Hear a song like from The Cure, you hear those chords.
Right.
And it takes you.
He started to play. Yeah. And he played a few, I think he played a Smiths song, and then he played a Bowie song, and I think he played Life on Mars or something. And it was like, now the song's in the room. It was this conjuring. There was something magical about it, where it was like, he'd play it, and suddenly we weren't, you know, just two guys sitting around, you know, in a room in some sleepy suburb. We were, you know, with these big ideas, you know, suddenly we were part of this world. And so it felt like this conjuring. And from like that moment on, I wanted to conjure things too. And I wanted to learn to play guitar. I wanted to learn to write songs. I was never one of these guys that learned all the licks, you know, those guys that can just wail in the closet and play all day. I just didn't care. I learned songs from artists that I like, and then I wrote my own songs from almost from the jump. I knew that this was an instrument. That's what its purpose was to help me, you know, write about how screwed up I felt a lot of the time. But it to also then participate in that same world of David Bowie and Robert Smith and Morrissey and people like that. They were in the room with us, you know.
And the weirdest part, I think, well, you became a music journalist.
A very bad
one. Which is how, what's that?
A very bad one.
Well, I was your editor for a short time, which is how we met about 17, 18 years ago.
That's right.
You did a couple of pieces for All Things Considered. I was the director of the show back then. You weren't a bad music journalist.
Well, thank you, Bob. I felt like a terrible music journalist because I didn't care about the journalism. I would interview my heroes and ask them how they wrote songs. And then I would try to figure out a way to like turn it into an article. I knew I had to write some, but all I really cared about was like, you know, meeting all these different people and asking them how they wrote the songs that I loved. And I got to meet a lot of great people. I had a great conversation with Tom Waits, with Lou Reed, with Stephen Malkmus, with, you know, also, and then Robert Smith and David Bowie. I got to meet them.
Which is, I mean, just think about that. I do. The things that we all can't imagine that can happen to us in our lives, right? You're this kid who finds the cure, starts strumming a guitar, and that not so many years later, you're in a room with David Bowie and Robert Smith. Talk about the advice, let's say, Robert Smith gave, and then what David Bowie, the sorts of things that they told
him. Robert Smith was querulous and strange, and every bit as Robert Smithy as you would hope he would be. You know, you're almost worried with someone like Robert Smith that if you meet him, he's just going to be like, hello, how are you? And just like, ah, damn it, he's normal. And he wasn't at all. He was sort of strange and wonderful and really bright. And we were in this hotel room. We had like it was one of these horrible industry listening parties where like the label is there and, you know, different journalists and he's just kind of
the worst things because the journalists don't listen to the music there. They talk.
Everyone's talking over the record and Robert Smith is standing there stiff as a board in the corner while everyone just kind of is in this high end cocktail party talking. And I was like, this is fucking weird. I think he was mad about it. So we got drunk together and it was like, I mean, come on. My heart, my cure loving heart to have this three hour conversation in a hotel room with Robert Smith. We just drank a bunch of beer and talked about our lives. And eventually I told him I wanted to write songs and that this is all a ruse. And I opened up about like, you know, I'm just trying to learn. And the biggest piece of advice, he gave me a few pieces of advice, but the biggest piece of advice is he's like, don't be normal. Don't worry if what you're writing sounds strange. Don't try to write what other people feel. Don't try to write what you think other people mm-hmm. are feeling. Write about precisely the contradictions that you are going through. Write about if you're feeling messed up, the very specific flavor of what that is in your own mind as you personally understand it. And don't worry about trying to be normal. I think the way he said it was, normal is everything I hate about life, which, you know, he's sort of like, he lives that idea.
Can you, the idea of writing about your contradictions, can you give me and everyone just a little about what that means to you? And I don't know if there's any songs that fits into the people would know. I know we want to play Graveyard Near the House. I don't know if it can lead us there.
Yeah, why don't I lead into Graveyard and we'll talk about that. So the Graveyard Near the House is a really good example of a song I started to write about the idea of true love from this perspective of knowing, you know, you're going to die someday. Also knowing that as you get older, or as a relationship gets older, you know, love often fades and people fade and bodies fade. So what does love look like if you're really being honest? And what I sort of told myself was don't.
So I'll just say that in this wonderful world of ours, you never know what's going to happen. That's always been true. And we just turned into question marks, Mikel. That's.
I mean, I'm more of a question mark than an exclamation point. That's for sure.
But you were saying, talking about the contradictions in songs and in the graveyard near the house that you're about to perform with Mimi.
Yeah, I was really interested in not shirking away from the challenges of that idea. And of course, you know, for me, I'd been in therapy and I'd seen a therapist about having been born and raised in an orphanage, and what you end up with is this crippling fear of closeness at the same time as you have this incredibly strong need for it. So both those things kind of simultaneously exist inside you when you've been, let's say, abandoned at an early age, which is how I think the kids from Synanon experienced it. And you know, I thought I emerged unscathed, because I was always so, I'm going to be upbeat, I'm going to try and achieve things. And then where it kind of came to a head for me was I had a real hard time with relationships for a lot of years, because of that. And so I wanted to write about that. And Robert Smith's words were just always echoing in my head of just write about the contradictions that you understand, write about your personal emotional experience, and don't just give me like, all you need is love, unless that's how you feel. Mm-hmm. But that isn't how I feel at all. I feel like this huge number of complex things about it. So we'll bring Mimi in, and we're going to give you, I guess, a little bit of, or all of, the graveyard near the house. Great. Hey, Mimi. Hey.
The other day when we were walking by the graveyard near the house, you asked me if I thought we would ever die. And if life and love both fade so predictably, we've made ourselves a kind of predictable lie. And so I pictured us like corpses lying side by side in pieces in some dark and lonely plot under a bough. We look so silly there, all decomposed, half turned to dust in tattered clothes, though we probably look just as silly now. Bye, 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 bye to all this dogged innocence. I can't pretend that I can tell you what is going to happen next or how to be. But you have no idea about me, do you? So it left me to wonder if people ever know each other or just stumble around like strangers in the dark. Cause sometimes you seem so strange to me, I must seem strange to you. We're like two actors playing our parts. Did you memorize your lines? Cause I did. Here's the part where I get so mad, I tell you that I can't forget your past. And you get so quiet now, and you seem somehow like a lost and lonely child, and you just hope that this moment won't last. Bye, 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 bye to all this dog-eared innocence. I can't pretend that I could tell you what is going to happen next or how to be. But you have no idea about me. You have no idea about me, do you? But there's always a way around. There's something tying our feet to the ground. A moment past, we hear how it sounds. Then it seems a little less profound, like we're all going the same way down. Cause we're all going the same way down. And I'm just trying to write it all down. Cause I write songs and you write letters. We are tied like two in tethers, and we talk and read and laugh and sleep at night in bed together. And you wake in tears sometimes. I can see the thoughts flash across your eyes. They say, darling, will you be kind? Will you be a good man and stay behind if I get old? and the letters all pass through my head with the words that I was told about the fading flesh of life and love, the failures of the bold. I can list each crippling fear like I'm reading from a will. And I'll defy everyone and love you still. I will carry you with me up every hill. And if you die before I die, I'll carve your name out of the sky. And then I'll fall asleep with your memory, and I'll dream of where you lie. Some say it's better to move on and to let life just carry on, and I may be wrong. It's better to love whether you win or lose or die. It's better to love whether you win or lose or die. It's better to love, and I will love you till I die.
You two sound so good together.
Thank you, Mimi.
Yeah.
She's a wonderful musician. I feel very lucky. Yeah.
Lots of applause in the chat room. Thank you for everybody in the chat room today. Two different brains, it seemed to me, are needed to write the words you put into this beautiful book. And then another complete other brain that only a few of us in life have is the one to be able to write songs, be able to connect with people with your songwriting. Talk about the relationship between the songs for the album Hollywood Park and the book. So obviously the book started first, I would imagine.
Yeah. I wrote the book. I was writing the book after my father died, and I was just so in this world emotionally that I was writing from. In the childhood world, some of the songs are written from the perspective of myself as a young child, you know, the anger that I felt of living on the run, or the fear I felt from running away, or all the different times in Synanon people had tried to escape, and the way that children had been ignored, and a lot about my father's life before I was born as well, because I'd spent a lot of time thinking about that once he died, as people do. And I guess if I'm being totally honest, there was a return to something. You know, we, as a band, we'd had a lot of time on the road. And when you know, you become a professional musician, I hate that term because we're not very professional about anything, you know, but there's always this pressure on you, and people want you to follow these arcane rules of songwriting or whatever. There's always like some asshole, and, you know, going like, write me a hit, kid, you know, give me like Wang Chung, 1981. You know, can you write me one of those hits? I want the title of the song to be the downbeat of the first chorus. Give me a middle eight and a minor key. And then, you know, an outro. You know, and I think if I'm being honest, I think a lot of that was in my head for a lot of years, because I felt, you know, I don't know, maybe like, is there something intoxicating about it? Something intoxicating about having success, and particularly in music, because you go on tour and people clap, and plus you, it's the way you make your living. When my dad died, I suddenly just needed music again, the way I had when I was a kid, or the way I had when I was, you know, first, let's say, starting out. And so there was a return to something. There was this sense of like, I don't give a shit about, you know, we'd been dropped by our record label, and, I knew Anna was leaving the band, and I just didn't give a shit about any of that anymore. And I just wanted to write from the heart. I wanted to write. The songs were weird and they didn't have choruses, or if there wasn't any hooks, because there's probably no hooks. And if there wasn't, you know, I didn't care. I just wanted to capture what I was going through. I wanted there to be a record of what I was going through. F. Scott Fitzgerald has this thing that the living a scholastic life, an artistic life, is no different than leading, you know, a life that isn't in the arts. You just leave a record, you know, or if you're a musician, you make a record. And that's really where I was coming from. I wanted to capture this moment. And I met with the band and we talked about it, and, you know, we were just like, all right, there's just kind of the four of us versus the world. It's Adrian and Steven and Darren. And it was like, you know, let's just go make something we love, you know, for all the reasons we love music. let's not make a record for anyone but ourselves. Let's not make a record for anything that's based on anything but, you know, the ways in which we love rock and roll. And it was this sense of like, we didn't know what was going to happen. We didn't have a deal. We didn't, I mean, I don't know. We just kind of locked ourselves in rooms and did it. And it felt like it was giving life to these stories. To some extent, I think they all knew my dad too. And there was a sense of honoring him, of just wanting to do this thing right. And I think some of the songs I was writing because I knew he would like them. It's a little more classic rock than other records. You know, our records go maybe from post-punk forward, but we've never really been like in this record. I think there's almost a sense of classic rock in parts of it. And I think it's partially because my dad loved classic rock. And I was trying to just write these things that I knew that would conjure his spirit and would be good and great for the reasons he loved music. And it was so like, it was too big to care about outcomes, if that makes any sense.
Yeah. But did it both writing the book and writing the music help you as a human understand your faults and Absolutely. Help you have a successful love? And because you ran away from so many and so many yeah. ran away from you. And I mean,
yeah, there was sort of a full circle moment that happened, my brother and I, while I was becoming a musician, after I stopped being a music journalist and started the band, which by the way, Bob told me to do.
Explain that to people?
Bob's history with me. I'd done some pieces for him at NPR, and I said, Bob, I want to write. I think I'm starting a band, but I'm not sure because my writing career is going pretty well. And Bob said, you can always write, go tour, go start a rock band. That's fun. Come back to writing later.
I didn't remember that at all.
And this was before Tiny Desk and all the ways that Bob has gone on to put its imprint on the entire music world. And we were just kind of two guys that love music and we were talking about it. And I was like, I don't know what to do. I'm scared to go take this big leap. And Bob was like, go take the leap, man. You're a good writer. You can always write. You'll come back to it if you need to. Just go take the leap. It was great advice, Bob. Thank you.
I'm proud of you, buddy.
While I was doing that, my brother had sort of fell deeper into addiction and eventually found himself after years of drinking on pills and then eventually to heroin. And you know, I was very scared when he finally did. Disclosed his sort of full addiction to me, and we took him to rehab, and he dried out. You know, I don't want to give too much away from the book, but his story is so incredible.
Indeed.
And I would go to these AA meetings, and I don't know if those of you know anything about program. I'm not a program person really, but like I'll go watch my brother share, and some of the best storytellers in the world, they're not doing TED Talks, they're not on, you know, public radio, they're at an AA meeting. You know, telling a story. They know how to do a beginning, a middle, and end. They know how to tell a joke. These people are storytellers. By the way, CA is the best stories. But anyways, and I remember just watching my brother have this sort of peace of mind, and he'd come to terms with a lot of sort of his demons. And here I am having finally some big success in my life, feeling so lost in, you know, the basics of love. I can't have a relationship. I'm not good at it. And I didn't know why. And so, you know, there's this idea that rock and roll can save you. You know, there's this peripatetic sense that you go on the road and, you know, you're just going to live out your dreams on this bus and be married to the road. And I'd made that decision for a while. This is what I do. And, you know, I came to sort of realize it was just kind of a cover for the fact that I was scared to face, you know, what was maybe not what was broken in myself. And it was hard to write about this too, because, you know, it as a person who always wants to come off as larger than life, it's hard to admit. You know, I was struggling. I was struggling there for a while, Bob. I was some dark, dark stuff, and it's hard to feel like you can't change. I had tried to change so many different ways. You know, you call a friend and, you know, try to work it out. You still can't change. You sort of whispered into a quiet ear at dawn, and you still can't change. And you write a song about it. You steep it in like metaphor and irony, and your volume of your voice is to some ungodly level, and there's thousands of people there now, and you're still stuck as the same person in your head and in your personal life, and you can't change. So the day came when I'd had enough, and I walked into this therapist office. It was a sunny little day, and I think it was Culver City, and I walked in, and there's this really warm sort of British man with these red cheeks sitting across from me, and he said, why are you here? Why do you want to seek therapy, and I said, without missing a beat, I said, I want to be able to fall in love, and I can't. And I know that I have to change. And that was hard. It was
That's hard to admit.
That, like, because you want to feel like a victim, because we were victims as children. We were victims. We were we were abused and beaten and ignored and neglected and put in an orphanage. And man, there was a lot of ways. And when you have that perspective about yourself, you think, all right, I've risen above it. And I ended up with a scholarship to Stanford. Like I like really kind of felt, saw myself as like, I transgressed all of this. I got out. And then you realize, no, you didn't get out. And then now, you know, you're responsible for your own change and your own self. And to admit that you, I had shortcomings and that I was bad at relationships, that was hard. But I really wanted to fall in love and I wanted to get married and I wanted to, you know, do all those sorts of things. And so 5 years on the couch on the twice a week for 5 years, Bob, I that's what I did. And I write about this in the book about, you know, learning the landscape of your mind. It's hard. It's painful. It's uncomfortable. It, you don't, you have to look at parts of yourself you don't want to look at. You have to sit with sadness or grief or shame or these uncomfortable things that you don't want to sit with. And then after a while, you start to get to know yourself and you start to make new decisions. And then eventually, in my case, I think I felt like I was ready to fall in love. And that's when I met my wife.
And you have. And in fact, can I just point out that there's a hand-drawn NPR logo above your book. Tell us about that.
My son made that. My three-year-old son knew that daddy was going to be doing a big NPR thing today. So he had a little help from mom, but that was his contribution. And boy, you know, we have two kids now. I have a three-year-old and a five-month-old. And it's it just, you know, becoming a father just, it was like I spent so many years feeling like I was on the outside looking in, either in this kind of like ne'er-do-well, you know, married to the road kind of way, or just as this kind of orphan kid that was always looking at families, wondering if I was ever going to have that. And to just have a son was just so much blinding joy. To have my daughter smile and look at me, it just brings this blinding peace and joy and this feeling of warmth. And to know what that requires of me is, you know, that I continue to stay, you know, aware of my own shortcomings and be able to be a good husband and a good father and a good friend and a good son and a good brother, and that, you know, learn those lessons. And a lot of those lessons I learned, you know, in therapy, and some of them were sitting there right out in the open that I'd learned from my dad, and from Bonnie as well, my mom, Bonnie. And so, I'd say that like, by the time, you know, he had died, I was ready. He was very sick for a while, and towards the end of his life, it was kind of one of these situations we knew he was going to go, as sometimes happens with people who are very sick, you know, in the modern world, you kind of know maybe within the week. So we'd all gone to the hospital. We're at Cedars-Sinai, and I walk in and there's my dad, and he's laying in the bed and he's got, you know, tubes in his arm and he's got one in his neck because he's very sick and he's so small and he's so frail. And I'd started dating my wife at that point, but we were just dating. And I said, "Hey, Dad." And he said, "What?" And I said, he's like, "Hey." And he's kind of coming in and out of consciousness because of the morphine. And I said, "I have something I want to tell you." He said, "Oh, yeah, what's that?" I said, "I'm going to ask her to marry me, Dad." Because he really liked my wife a lot. He, first time he met her, he said, "You should marry that girl," which he was right. And he said, "Oh, that's great." And then he kind of paused and he looked up at me and he said, "Don't." And I was confused for a minute. And I was like, is he questioning marriage? Is he questioning my choice? Is it the morphine? And he sort of cracked a smile and he put his hand on my cheek and he said, "Don't fuck it up." And those are those are the last words. That was the last conversation that we ever had. And that's my dad. You know, is exactly, he knows me well enough to know that's what I needed to hear. He's sort of joking with me. And he's wise and loving all at the same time. That's who he was. So, you know, a lot of my life was spent, you know, admiring him, running away from him, and then eventually wanting very much to have that same warm center of my heart that he had. That despite, you know, all the years, the time he got, he was in Chino prison, or, you know, he'd gotten out and he'll have to stay at the racetrack, which is why Hollywood Park is named for, because we would spend a lot of long afternoons through the years at Hollywood Park. He went there the day he got out of prison. He took a Greyhound bus and shot dice in the back and won 14 bucks and then put it on a horse, all on one horse.
And he would take you?
And then when I was a kid, he would take me. And then I grew up, I learned fractions at Hollywood Park. And it was kind of our place. That's where our father-son bond happened, was we would go to a day at the races. And him with his shady friends. Hey, Jimmy, you teaching them the family business? You know, that was always Hollywood Park. And here are these little toehead kids with our, like, dad with this cool cafe jacket and his cowboy boots and his, like, kind of swagger.
You got a couple of remnants I know you brought to the studio.
Because we're talking about Hollywood Park, this is actually a sign that I stole from Hollywood Park,
which closed down. You were there the last day.
They actually destroyed the grandstand 3 weeks after my father died. So it was always a big blazing metaphor for me.
The mic's hiding some of the thing. You want to read it to us?
The sign says, when wagering, please indicate the track name and race number. Also, please check your tickets and money before leaving the window. So this is what you would see if you waited in line in Hollywood Park to make a bet. And so I kept it as a keepsake. And this was above my desk as I was writing the book. And then my wife likes to get me these. I have these, like, great old brochures. I don't know if you can see, but they're like, you know, old Hollywood Park racetracks. You know, brochures from back in the day, and has all its arcane language and all these, like, great little drawings of people and horse racing. And my dad loved a day at the races. And, you know, there was always a sense that we were safe there. I always knew it would be the title of the book. I always knew it would be the title of the record. I always, because the place felt magic. And the fact that he went there every Saturday, and then, you know, when he died, they shut it down. And it felt like, here's this metaphor, here's this place, and it can't exist anymore. It was almost like I felt like we invented it. Like, it could only exist with him alive. And if he's not alive,
what's the use? Why
would it exist? And a lot of things feel that way to me now. They're like these big, intricate structures in your life that become these big, intricate memories. And it's not something I think I understood at 15, that the loss of people is so profound that you create entire worlds where you can talk to them in your mind. And I still talk to my dad almost every single day. And so one of the great parts about writing the book and the record was I got to honor him, but also I got to be with him. I got to hang out with him. I got to ask him a lot of questions about the story, and I got to hear in my head, like, what his answer was.
Did your dad ever get to see the band?
Oh, he loved the band. Are you kidding me? Yeah. Oh, he saw the band everywhere we went. He saw the last show he went to was at the Greek, when we played the Greek Theater in LA. And, like, he wanted me to bring him on stage. He's like, I was going to sit in on choir.
Is he going to sing?
Yeah. And you know what? I wish I had. At the time, I was like, Dad, oh, come on. You know, I can't be doing that. You know, I'm in a big rock band, whatever. And if I could go back and do it again, I would have brought
him. Yeah, you would.
Like, it's one show. Would have made his whole life. He would have loved it. Right. And did have a good voice. He had, like, a baritone. He was a good voice. Oh, and
that's beautiful.
He loved the band, though. I think to some extent, he couldn't quite relate to my very academic side, the part of me that was like the
Stanford NCAA side.
Contest winner. And yeah, they went to Stanford and had all this sort of academic accolades and stuff. But then when I was like, I abandoned all that around the time you and I had the talk, you know, I was like, I'm leaving all the NPR stuff and the music journalism and the fiction writing I've been doing, and I'm going to start a band. And everyone thought I was nuts. And my dad was like, go for it. I think he just loved having a son that was going to play rock and roll. You know, that was the thing.
I wish you could have heard this song. Why don't you take us out? Thank you for doing this. And this book, I don't cry too much, but thinking about this book and your story, it's so beautiful. And that I listen to the audiobook. I'm an audiobook person, so I hear you telling me the story. It's a beautiful way to experience it. But in any way you do, if for those of you who are in the chat room and haven't touched this book or maybe just read the first chapter, you know what's in store. And go for it and enjoy it. And Mikel, thanks for doing this. This is not just about, this book is not just about you. I think it certainly got me thinking about my life, and I think it'll do that for many. So,
well, I really appreciate you having us here today, Bob, and thank you so much for all the good advice and for all you do for the music. There's a lot of us that feel really happy for what you've done for the music world, and giving a voice to artists that aren't necessarily wouldn't have the platforms they had. So you've been a good guy for a lot of us for a long time. So thank you for that.
Thank you, my friend. Bring back Mimi, and we'll close out. Take care, all. We'll go out on Hollywood Park.
This is Hollywood Park.
this moment from my bed. Tired from lifting my legs, tired from drifting around through the dust, all the dust, and all this time that I would spend. But I never claimed I knew how this would end, or the order of the horses at the bend. All I knew is I would be back again, and we'd stand here as the world fell apart at Hollywood Park.
Thank you all so much for joining us.